Hi everybody and welcome to a new exciting video in the audio signal processing for machine learning series. Last time we introduced the extraction pipelines for both time domain and frequency domain features. This time I'm going to be introducing time domain audio features. Specifically, I'm going to focus on a few very important time domain audio features and explain the theory behind them. But before we get started, let me remind you once again about the Sound of AI Slack community. This is a community of people interested in all things AI audio, AI music, audio signal processing. So if you want to improve your knowledge in the field and network with great people, I highly suggest you to go check out the sign up link that I've left in the description below. Now on to the good stuff. Okay, so these are the three time domain features that we'll be focusing on today. So these are amplitude, envelope, root mean square energy, and zero crossing rate. So all of these features are low level acoustic features and they are instantaneous. In other words, we take these features at each frame in an audio signal. Then obviously we can just like take like all of these values that we have for each frame and then we can aggregate them with some statistical means like mean, sum, or things that are a little bit more sophisticated like Gaussian mixture models. So if you don't remember like the definition of a frame or like the categorization of audio features, I highly suggest you go check out this video up here that will clarify all of those things for you. The first time domain feature that we'll look into is the amplitude envelope, and that's the max amplitude value taken out of all the samples that we have in a frame. Now, I'll show you the math for calculating that. Don't be scared because I'll break it down piece by piece for you. What we want to find is the amplitude envelope at frame T. So it's a specific frame. So now let's start with this S of K. So what's that? Well, that's just like the amplitude calculated at sample K. Now, another ingredient that we want to know about is this capital K, which is the frame size, or in other words, the number of samples that we have in a given frame. Okay, so now we want to take the max amplitude value of all the samples in a frame. So we have to define this max between the first sample of frame T, and we can access that by multiplying the frame we are at. So this could be like frame 0, 1, 2, whatever you want, and capital K, which is the frame size, and this will give the first sample of frame T. And we want to calculate the max, as we said, between first sample of frame T and obviously the last sample of frame T. And we can calculate this by first of all accessing the next frame, and that is like T plus 1. We want to multiply that by the frame size, and these will give us the first sample of frame T plus 1. So we want to go back to the last frame of T, and so we have to subtract 1 to T plus 1 multiplied by K, right? Okay. So this is the amplitude envelope at frame T, but we know that what we want to do is to calculate the amplitude envelope for all the frames. So for each frame in an audio signal, we are going to use these formula here. Okay, I know this can feel a little bit abstract. So let's try to visualize this to like understand this like a process a little bit better. So here we have like our normal audio signal. Here I'm going to take like a few I'm going to be framing this audio signal. So this is the first frame, second frame, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, right? And I can continue. Once again, if you don't remember what framing is, what like all of this like, yeah, things, concepts are, it's like frames, just go back to a couple of videos ago in this series because they're like explain this like very in depth. Okay, so now how do we get the amplitude envelope here? Well, what we do, like what we did mathematically, now we can do visually. In other words, we want to take for each frame the highest value, the max value of the amplitude. And it's this guy, little guy here in green. Now, if we move to the second frame, we have like this guy here, that's the max value. Here we have like this max value that's over here. Here for the fourth, fifth frame, we'll go here, and I expect for the sixth frame to have the max amplitude over here. Okay, so this is like visually what we are, what we did earlier, like with a mathematical formula. Okay, I hope like this is clear. It's quite like simple to grasp, like once you understand the intuition behind it. Okay, now, the question is, so what does like amplitude envelope tell us about the audio signal? Well, it gives us like a rough idea of the loudness of the signal, and that's obviously because the amplitude is related with intensity and therefore loudness. Okay, so the problem with the amplitude envelope is that it is like very sensitive to outliers, and that's because you're just like getting one value, one sample, the amplitude for one sample out of all the samples that you have in a frame. And so you may have like an outlier. So in other words, you may have like a frame like that has like all, let's say almost like zero amplitude for all samples, and then you have a spike, and then you get that spike, but that spike isn't really that representative of the whole frame, right? That's the basic idea why amplitude envelope is sensitive to outliers. Now, where do we use amplitude envelope? Well, it can be used in a bunch of different applications, but a few like important ones are like onset detection. In other words, like onset detection is basically, so if you have like a note, you want to just like understand when that note like starts. It could be a musical note, it could be like the utterance of a word or a phoneme. And so with amplitude envelope, you can kind of like guess where that like event, acoustic event starts. And that's because amplitude envelope gives us information about amplitude. And you would expect that at an onset, you have like a burst of energy, so a spike in the amplitude. And we can also use amplitude envelope for higher level classification problems, like music genre classification, for example. Now, I'm not gonna show you like graphs or visualizations like of amplitude envelope here, like in this video, but in the next, we'll be looking at the comparison like of amplitude envelope taken for like different pieces of music from different genres, and we'll see if indeed there is a difference there. Okay, so stay tuned for that. But now let's move on to the second time domain audio feature that's called root mean square energy. So what we do here is basically we took the root mean square of all the samples in a frame. Okay, so I know like if you're not familiar with like statistics and math, like this once again can sound like very scary, and indeed this formula doesn't help much, but once again I'm going to break this down so you can understand that. So here what we are doing is we are taking the root mean square energy at frame T. Once again, as we said, all of these audio features are instantaneous, so we take the values for each frame. Okay, so here the new thing, which shouldn't be like too new for you, is the as this S of K, which is the amplitude at the sample K, but it's squared this time. So if we have like the square of the amplitude, basically we have the energy. So this guy is the energy of the kth sample. So what we do here is we sum the energy for all the samples in frame T. Once again, like this is just like the sum symbol, and we are like adding up like all the energy for all the samples in frame T. And then once we have like this sum, what we want to do is we want to take the mean of the sum of the energy, and we'll achieve that by dividing the sum of the energy by the frame size, which is the number of samples that we have in the given frame. And after we've done that, we just apply the root over here, and that's it. So basically we have the root mean square energy. Now, once again, the root mean square energy is an indicator of loudness, because energy is strictly related to loudness. And the great thing about root mean square energy, and one of the reasons why like it is like overwhelmingly used, at least like in traditional like audio digital signal processing, is that it is less sensitive to outliers than the amplitude envelope. And this is because we're not just like sampling a single sample value for a frame, but rather we're just like getting information from all the samples, and then we take like the root mean square for that's calculated across like all the samples. And so in this way, we are less sensitive to outliers, like spikes in amplitude in one sample in all of the frames. Okay, so now, what are the applications for root mean square energy? Once again, there are many, many applications here. I want to talk about a couple of these. So we can use root mean square energy for identifying new segments in an audio signal. And that's because the RMS tends to like change quite a lot when you have like new segments, new like events. And so we can leverage root mean square energy for all things like in audio segmentation. It could be done like for example, like for deciding like whether like someone is talking or it's not talking, and you have like this change and you want to segment who's talking and things like that. And obviously we can also use RMS for music genre classification, and we'll see some of this like over the next few videos in action. The third time domain audio feature that I want to introduce in this video is called zero crossing rate. This is a quite popular acoustic feature used both in speech recognition and in music information retrieval. And it's a quite intuitive one because it provides us information about the number of times that a signal crosses the horizontal axis. So before getting into the math, let's visualize this. Okay, so here we have a signal, a simple signal worth of a frame, we can assume, and then the zero crossing rate is equal to the count of like these green dots. Okay, so for each of these green dots, we have a crossing of the horizontal axis. In other words, like for this signal, the zero crossing rate is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, now the question is, how do we calculate the zero crossing rate mathematically? Well, here you have the formula for that. Once again, don't be scared about this. We'll just like break it down. Okay, the basic intuition here is that we compare the amplitude value for consecutive pairs of samples, and we look at whether like there are differences like in the signs of those amplitude for those consecutive samples. Okay, so first of all, we should familiarize with this sine function, if you're not familiar with that already. Basically, what the sine function, which is indicated by this SGN, what it does, it gives us back the sine of a given value. So in this case, for example, if the amplitude is greater than zero, the sine function gives us back +1. That's because the amplitude is positive. If the amplitude is negative, we get back -1. If the amplitude is equal to zero, we get back zero. Now, how do we calculate the zero crossing rate like for each pair of samples? Well, what we do is we take the sine for the amplitude at sample k, And then we subtract to that the sine for the amplitude at sample k plus one. So it's, we are basically comparing the two consecutive samples here. Now, the cool thing about this is that if we have both amplitude values that have like the same sign, so if they're both plus or minus, what happens here is that we get out of this just like zero. So we don't get like any information regarding, well, we don't get any value that it's going to increase the zero crossing rate. But if we have alternate opposite signs, so say for example, like at sample k, we have like a negative amplitude, and at sample k plus one, we have a positive sample. So what happens is that we get a value of two here. And that's because, yeah, let's just like take a look at this. So if we have like minus here, it means like that we have like minus one, minus plus one gives us like minus two. We have to take the absolute value of that. So that's equal to two. But now we are, so this is going to give us information only for one zero crossing, not two. So we have to divide this two by two, and it's given over here, so that we're going to have just like a value of one here. Now, what we do is we kind of like sum over all the samples that we have in a frame, and so that we are going to get like the values for all the zero crossings that we have in a frame. Okay, so that's like a simple like mathematical formula that's very elegant for defining zero crossing rate. Now let's take a look at some applications. As I said, this is like zero crossing rate is extensively used in speech recognition, as well as like in music processing. So we can use zero crossing rate for recognizing percussive versus like pitched sounds. And that's because percussive sounds usually tend to have like quite random like zero crossing rate. So like they tend to change like the zero crossing rate like quite a lot, whereas like pitched sounds tend to be like way more stable in the zero crossing rates. And we can also use zero crossing rate as a very rudimentary like monophonic pitch estimation algorithm. In other words, there's a kind of like relationship between like the number of zero crossings like and the pitch. And if we have like a monophonic pitch, basically the idea is like that the higher the number of zero crossings that we have, and the higher the pitch is going to be. Now, this is not bulletproof, and now we have like way more sophisticated monophonic pitch estimators, but zero crossing rate still like is a basic idea that we can use like to get monophonic pitch estimation. And finally, if we want to look at the speech recognition like space, we can use zero crossing rate for distinguishing between signals which contain like voice and signals that are like usually that are unvoiced. And that's because when we're like dealing with like voice signal, we usually have like a zero crossing rate like that is like lower than what we have like in unvoiced like pieces of signals. And that probably has to do with the fact that like those unvoiced parts are like noisier, and yeah, and that's the case. In the next few videos, we'll get our hands dirty and implement this time domain audio features and use sometimes also Librosa for extracting them directly from audio signals. But specifically, for the next video, we'll implement the amplitude envelope from scratch, and then we'll visualize the amplitude envelope for pieces of music which come from different music genres, so that we can appreciate if there is any difference of amplitude envelope for different genres. Okay, that's all for today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If that's the case, please remember to leave a like. If you have any questions, as usual, feel free to leave a comment in the comment section below, and I'll see you next time. Cheers.